Yeah, I just asked. Hey, Gil. Hey, boy. They're going out front. They want to get up the front. Hey, Ottery.
Morning. Welcome to McKee Road Baptist Church. Let's go ahead and stand together. We'll have a word of prayer, and then we'll continue standing, and we'll sing a song, okay? It's good to have each and every one of you here this morning. Be in prayer as we begin the services today for Wanda. Her sister went home to be with the Lord, and I would imagine they're going to have a service here after some time. She'll let us know, but hug on Wanda. Let her know you love her and you're praying for her. Pray for one another as we have the service today, that God would have his will and way in our lives. And then when we have time to sing, worship together. Okay? Let's pray. Father, we ask that today you would do something that only you can do. God, we pray that as we come here that you might receive our worship. We thank you so much for your love and mercy shown us. God, we thank you for shed blood of Jesus
Christ, which gives us the opportunity to know you, him as personal Savior. Father, I'd ask that today we would listen with open hearts. We'd remember Revelation 3:20, as you're standing at our heart's door and you would have fellowship with us. But God, we got to let you in. That means we put aside all those troubles and problems that we're thinking about And God, just give you some time today. God, be with those that are sick, cannot be here, but would be. I pray for those that perhaps are spiritually sick, God, that should be here, but they're not. Lord, have your woven way. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Turn me down just a little bit, George. Song number 311 is Redeemed. 311. All the songs are in a dark blue. Redeemed. Again, Alice is not here, so be in prayer for her, if you will. Redeemed. 311. I'll try not to start it too low. You got that ready, George? Okay. Here we go. Redeemed, how I loved, will claim it. Redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed through His infinite mercy, His child and forever am. Redeemed, redeemed, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed through His infinite mercy, His child and forever I am. I think I got the wrong one. Redeemed and so happy in Jesus, no language my rapture can tell. I know that the light of His presence with me doth continually dwell. Redeemed, redeemed. Redeemed and so happy in Jesus, forever I am. I've got the wrong song, but just stay with me. I think of my blessed Redeemer. I think of Him all the day long. I sing, for I cannot be silent. His love is the theme of my song. Redeemed, redeemed. The blood of the Lamb, redeemed and so happy in Jesus, His child and forever I am. I know I shall see in His beauty the King in whose law I delight, who lovingly guardeth my footsteps and giveth songs in the night. Redeemed, redeemed, Lamb, redeemed and so happy in Jesus, forever I am. Amen. Thanks for bearing with me. You may be seated. Young people, come on and help me sing. Come on and help me sing. We're going to sing Lord's Army again. Lord's Army. Okay. Come on. Bless you. Come on. Girls? You're outnumbered. The girls are outnumbered. Okay. All right. Lord's Army. You guys know it? Ready to sing? Sing nice and loud. Adults, sing with us. I may never ride in the cavalry, shoot the artillery. I may never zoom o'er the enemy, but I'm in the Lord's army. Yes, sir. I'm in the Lord's army. Yes, sir. I'm in the Lord's army. Yes, sir. I may never march in the infantry, ride in the cavalry, shoot the artillery. I may never zoom o'er the enemy, but I'm in the Lord's army. Yes, sir. Anybody have a memory verse today? Anybody have a memory verse? No? Okay. Adults, you may stand and fellowship with one another as the young people get their candy. Okay? Go ahead and get your two pieces of candy. Hey. Hey, give me a hug there. Love you. There you go. Good for you, Dwayne. Hey, Judd. Huh? Go Padres.
Go Padres.
Peter, do you make it over to Philippines?
Yeah, my wife arrived there 3 days ago, then the funeral 2 days ago.
Okay. Okay.
Usually they attended also Baptist church there, right? So they have a service
at
Baptist
church. Okay. So now are they across the date line?
Huh?
Are they across the date line?
Yeah, they're 15 hours ahead of us.
Wow, 15 hours ahead. All right, good. Oh, I didn't get to say hi to Eleanor. Hi, Eleanor. Hi, Eleanor. All right, let's sing. I'm going to let you sit on the premises while we sing Standing on the Promises, okay? Standing on the Promises. Okay. Standing on the promises of Christ, my King, through eternal ages let his praises ring. Glory in the highest I will shout and sing, standing on the promises of God. Standing, standing, standing on the promises of God, my Savior. Standing, standing, I'm standing on the promises of God. Standing on the promises that cannot fail when the howling storms of doubt and fear assail. By the living word of God I shall prevail. Standing on the promises of God. Standing, standing, standing on the promises of God, my Savior. Standing, standing, I'm standing on the promises of God. Standing on the promises, Christ the Lord, bound to Him eternally by love's strong cord. Overcoming daily with the Spirit's sword. Standing on the promises of God. Standing, standing, standing on the promises of God, my Savior. Standing, standing, I'm standing on the promises of God. Standing on the promises, I cannot fall. Listening every moment to the Spirit's call. Resting in my Savior as my all in all. Standing on the promises of God. Let me hear you sing it. Amen. Oh, amen. That's good singing. All right, let's sing Victory in Jesus. Victory in Jesus. I heard an old story, how a Savior came from glory, how He gave His life on Calvary to save a wretch like me. I heard about His groaning. his precious blood atoning. Then I repented of my sins and won the victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and bought me with his redeeming blood. Praise God! He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is due him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. Did I start that too low? That's good. You like that? I heard about his healing, of his cleansing power revealing, how he made the lame to walk again and caused the blind to see. And then I cried, dear Jesus, come and heal my broken spirit. And somehow Jesus came and brought to me the victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is due him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. I heard about a mansion he has built for me in glory. And I heard about the streets of gold beyond the crystal sea, about the angels singing and the old redemption story. And some sweet day I'll sing up there the song of victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and bought me with his redeeming blood. Praise God! He loved me ere I knew him. His due him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. One last song. Tell me the story of Jesus. Stand with me if you will as we sing this. Tell me the story of Jesus. Write on my heart every word. Here we go. Tell me the story of Jesus. Write on my heart every word. Tell me the story most precious, sweetest that ever was heard. Tell how the angels in chorus sang as they welcomed his birth. Glory to God in the highest, peace and good tidings to earth. Tell me the story of Jesus, write on my heart every word. Tell me the story most precious, sweetest that ever was heard. Fasting alone in the desert, tell of the days that are past. How for our sins he was tempted, yet was triumphant at last. Tell of the years of his labor, Tell of the sorrow he bore. He was despised and afflicted, homeless, rejected, and poor. Tell me the story of Jesus, write on my heart every word. Tell me the story most precious, sweetest that ever was heard. Tell of the cross where they nailed him, writhing in anguish and pain. Tell of the grave where they laid him. Tell how he liveth again. Love in that story so tender, clearer than ever I see. Stay, let me weep while you whisper, love paid the ransom for me. Tell me the story, write on my heart every word. Tell me the story most precious, sweetest that ever was heard. Amen. You may be seated. Take your Bibles and open to the book of 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 28. We're continuing our study on the gifts, and we are, this is the second week on the permanent edifying gifts. We will continue on edifying gifts next week and maybe the and subsequent weeks. We're taking our time. It's kind of like the book of Acts. We're taking a nice slow walk through this. We don't want to run through it and say, here are the gifts, and there you are, and boom, you're done with it. But 1 Corinthians chapter 12, 28 says, and God hath set some in the church, first apostles, secondarily prophets, thirdly teachers, after that miracles, then gifts of healings, helps, governments, diversities of tongues. It's time to go into God's word. Are you ready? Let's all bow our heads. I want you to just take a moment and say in your heart, speaking to God, God, I know that your word says that where two or three are gathered together, that you're here in our midst. And we praise and worship you for that, God. But God, am I really ready to meet with you? If I'm not, God, prepare my heart that it would be. God, meet with us today. We need your meeting. We need your leading. We need your direction. Thank you so much for salvation. But dear God, anyone that has read Scripture understands and knows that's just the starting point. That's just realizing that we've got a home in heaven and we never have to fear the hell again, dear God. Father, grow us. May we edify one another through our gifts this morning. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Permanent edifying gifts. We need to try to determine our behavior this morning, and we need to consider the requirements of the Spirit's control. Talking about the Holy Spirit controlling your life. Walk in the Spirit. Be filled with the Spirit. Not be drunk with wine. Be filled with the Spirit. Every one of us, the moment we believe, receive the Holy Spirit. That's just difficult to comprehend if you stop and think about it. Part of the Trinity, all God, the Holy Spirit, comes and indwells us. Can you get a hold of that this morning? I mean, that's how much he loves you. Almighty God indwells you this morning through his Holy Spirit. And he takes up residence in our lives. And from the moment you believe, the Spirit of God came to live within you. He becomes your guide. Are you allowing the Holy Spirit to guide you this morning? He becomes your truth teacher. I don't know if that's right or wrong. Your truth teacher. And it becomes your power supply for everything you will do in the glory of God. And since the Spirit of God lives within us and is the guide, and is the power supply and is the truth teacher. The New Testament urges us to behave in a certain way relative to the Spirit. There's a certain way that we should live. For example, it tells us to what? It tells us to walk in the Spirit. It tells us to live in the Spirit. It tells us to be filled with the Spirit. It tells us to pray in the Spirit. It tells us to manifest the fruit of the Spirit and to use and to exercise the gifts of the Spirit. And then on the negative side, that's the positive, we're warned what? Not to grieve the Spirit. You're warned not to resist the Spirit when that Spirit comes to you and says, oh, no, wait a minute. You're to the point where you're going to make a decision, because that God knows our thoughts. He knows what's in our heart. You're going to make a decision, and what's going to happen is you're going to be resisting my Spirit. We're not to do that. And then also we're not to quench the Spirit. Sometimes we're guilty of God's doing a work and moving throughout the body, and we've come in with a bad attitude, or we think our problems are so great that we can just display a grumpy spirit, and everybody's rejoicing in the Lord, and then that ugly spirit comes in, and it just like throwing water on the fire. All this comes together to show us how vitally important it is that we operate in the area of the sphere of the Holy Spirit. That's why we're talking about the gifts of the Spirit. The Christian life should be a Spirit-dominated, a Spirit-directed, and a Spirit-controlled existence. Unfortunately, most Christians are fleshly, and we exclude the Spirit. We're thankful for that salvation, but we don't let His Spirit influence us. Second, consider the results of the Spirit's control. When we allow the Spirit of God to reign in our lives, to have control, and to give direction, marvelous results occur. A lot of times we go, well, why are all these bad things happening to me? Well, sometimes bad things happen just because bad things happen. But sometimes we put ourselves in a position, in a situation, where we can't experience the joy and the peace that God would have us have. So marvelous results occur when we allow the Spirit of God to reign in our lives. First, holiness. Holiness. Jesus said, be ye holy, for I am holy. Under the direction and control of the Spirit of God, get that? Under the direction and the control of the Spirit of God, a complete domination by the Spirit of God of our life pattern results in a constant sanctification or holiness. Holiness. When the Holy Spirit of God has full control of your life, you can walk in holiness. Why? Because those decisions or those habits or even those addictions that we are control us no longer control us. Second thing you have is joy. A constant satisfaction occurs when we walk and live in the Spirit. It doesn't mean that there's not problems going on in your life. Certainly life happens. Bad things happen. But I can have joy in my life because I'm consumed by the Holy Spirit. The third thing we get, and this goes back to those choices and addictions we talk about, there's liberty. There's liberty. The Bible tells us in 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 17, it says, where the Spirit of the Lord is, what? His Holy Spirit. What's it say? There is liberty. What's liberty? It's freedom. It's freedom. You see, I'm not perfect, but as a child of God, I have the freedom not to sin. And what does sin do? Sin just puts you in chains and bondage. Fourth, it gives you a confidence. It's a constant security occurs when we walk in the Spirit. When you're walking in the Spirit, so many Christians deal with, I don't know if I really got saved. I don't know what's happening. They're looking at the evidences in their life of how they're living, and they know that the Holy Spirit's convicting them that they should walk a circumspectly a certain way, and yet because they're walking in a way that's not under the control of the Spirit, their doubts. You can have confidence. Fifth is a victory, a constant strength against the adversary, that devil, the world, and your own flesh. And so holiness and joy and liberty and security, or confidence and victory, all result from walking in the Spirit. And there's a sixth one. It's ministry. It's ministry. It's a constant service to the body as you minister here within this body of Christ. So that when we walk in the Spirit, not only are there personal results, personal holiness and joy and confidence and those things, but there is another result, which is that we are able to minister to others and to build them up into Christ. Why did I come to church this morning? Well, you came to be with brothers and sisters in Christ. You came to sing praises to God. You came to worship God in your way and collectively together. But you came also together that you could minister one to another to the body and be an encouragement. As I walk in the Spirit, I minister my gift to you. So the same token, when you walk in the Spirit, you minister your gift to me and others, and so on. So defining your gift, first the issue is walk in the Spirit. People seem to always want to know, what is my gift? What is my gift? I have been in churches, and I've even taken the tests where they go through and answer all these questions. Anybody ever done that? And they say, and you answer all these questions, you go, that's your gift. You know, that's your gift. Well, I don't really think that's the issue. I think we get hung up on that, and that's not where we should be focusing. We don't need to necessarily define our gift. The issue is walk in the Spirit. There you go. That's where you start with. Well, what's my gift? Don't even worry about that. Walk in the Spirit. Start to walk in the Spirit. See, if I walk, live, and am filled, if I walk in the Spirit, if I live in the Spirit, and I'm filled in the Spirit, it's not too important for me to understand the definition of my gift. It won't matter to me. It's a matter of getting on your knees and asking the Spirit of God to dominate and control your life. How many of us do that of a morning? God, I'm giving myself to you again today. I want you to control me fully. I want you to control my thoughts. I want you to control where I walk, where I go, what I do. I want you to keep Satan at bay, dear God. That's what we need, should be praying. And as you yield him to him, the Spirit of God operates through you. And that will be your area of ministry. I get in trouble here because I'm going off my notes. In baseball, playoffs are going on right now. Baseball has changed so much in just my lifetime. So many rule changes, different changes. It used to be that when you came up to play in the big leagues, you had to be a five-tool player. You had to be able to run, hit, throw, hit for average, and there's another one that I'm missing. But those five things they would talk about you doing. But it's become specialized. Baseball, sometimes you might have a guy that's sitting on the bench that's extremely fast, and they put him in if they want him to steal a base. Or they have a pitcher. I remember there was a left-handed pitcher that was a very effective pitcher against left-handed hitters, and they'd bring him in and let him try to strike out one guy. And it's become specialized. I kind of think that's the way we think when it comes to gifts. We think it's specialized, and I've got just one area that I've got a gift in. No, stay with me. Here's the problem. When you start trying to define your gift, you're going to run into some problems because there's so much overlapping of the gifts. There's a story, and I don't know if anybody, has anyone ever sat and had their portrait painted? You've sat and had that? And what happens? I'm told the artist will come out and have a palette. And on that palette, now guys, if you're like me, you're thinking a palette, you're sitting merchandise on. No, that's not it. It's a palette, and it has several different primary colors on it. And they have a little palette, like a spoon or something that you mix the colors with. And you take that palette, and you mix those primary colors out together. And it becomes very amazing of all the combination of colors that came out of those primary colors. And that artist then begins to put that painting on the canvas. That's exactly how the Spirit, spiritual gifts function. The Holy Spirit has a palette. On it are some primary gifts, what we're talking about. They are the gifts that are listed in Scripture. But by the time they are spread around, there's a mixture. Each one of you becomes a very stylized, a very individualized, very particular, unique portrait. When we study the five speaking gifts and the six serving gifts that make up the permanent edifying gifts, we are simply studying those primary colors. Okay? And the Holy Spirit will then take and mix them, and He'll put them on you like no one else. The combinations are unique. That's why you have trouble finding definitions. That's my spiritual gift. In our last lesson, we began studying the permanent edifying gifts. And after studying the gifted men, there are two general categories for these gifts as illustrated. 1 Peter chapter 4, if you'll turn there. 1 Peter chapter 4. We go through the studies and what have you. But folks, there's a place where you have to make application in your life, okay? We can impart knowledge all we want. But if there's not application, then the wisdom is not being imparted. 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 10 through 11 says, "As every man hath received the gift, even so minister the same one to another as good stewards of the manifold grace of God. If any man speak, let him speak as the oracles of God. If any man minister, let him do it as of the ability which God giveth, that God in all things may be glorified through Jesus Christ, to whom be praise and dominion forever and ever. Amen." Speaking of gifts and serving gifts, in the last lesson, we looked at five speaking gifts, which are five primary colors, okay? Any of which can be mixed together. Those gifts are prophecy, knowledge, wisdom, teaching, and exhortation. They're all related to the speaking the Word of God. Prophecy proclaims God's Word. Knowledge clarifies God's Word. Wisdom applies God's Word. Here's the knowledge. I got it. Now I need to apply it in my life. Teaching imparts God's Word. And exhortation does what? It demands that God's Word be obeyed. Exhort you. Obey God's Word. All five are related to speaking in relationship to God's revelation. The serving gifts. The second category of permanent edifying gifts is the serving gifts. The serving gifts are geared for what? Service. They're geared for service. The issue is not to proclaim the Word of God. The issue there is serving someone's need or needs. Have you ever served someone's need or needs? I would submit that probably most all of us have. And some people do it on a regular basis. These six serving gifts are primary colors that can be mixed, guess what, with the speaking gifts sometimes and each other to turn out unique combinations in the case of every individual Christian. What I was saying, basically in a nutshell, is that God, as He takes the palette of these gifts and He spreads them over your life, You can serve in so many different capacities, these gifts, using these gifts that God has enabled you to have. Now, these gifts occur in two passages. Turn to back to 1 Corinthians 12:28. 1 Corinthians 12:28. And then we'll be in Romans 12 right after that. 1 Corinthians 12:28, it says, "And God hath set some in the church, first apostles, secondarily prophets, thirdly teachers, after that miracles, then gifts of healings, helps, governments, diversities, and of tongues." And in Romans chapter 12, verses 6 through 8, Romans 12, 6 through 8, Romans 12, 6 through 8, it says, "Having then gifts differing according to the proportion of faith or ministry, let us wait on our ministering, or he that teacheth on teaching, or he that exhorteth on exhortation, he that giveth, let him do it with simplicity, he that ruleth with diligence, he that showeth mercy with cheerfulness." So the first point here is leadership. In Romans 12:8, "Or he that exhorted on exhortation, he that giveth, let him do it with simplicity, he that ruleth with diligence, he that showeth mercy with cheerfulness." And then back in 12:28 of 1 Corinthians, "And God has set some in the church, first apostles, secondarily prophets, thirdly teachers, after that miracles, then gifts, healings, helps, and governance, diversities of tongues." First thing we need to look at is definition of terms. The word is ruling in Romans 12 and governments in 1 Corinthians 12:28. Both refer to leadership. They are synonymous. They both refer to leadership. The word ruleth means this. It means to lead, to manage, to have charge of, to oversee, or to rule. That's leadership, right? The word governments basically means the same thing, but it also has a unique literal meaning. It means to steer a ship. To steer a ship. It is the Greek word kubernesis. It refers to the skill of piloting a ship. Now, if we ever get in the water and we're in a boat, you don't want me to pilot the ship, okay? I don't know what I'm doing. But it refers to the skill of piloting a ship. To the one who is at the helm of the ship, who charts the course, who knows the destination, and who is able to keep the ship on course. Leadership. Leadership. Leadership is the ability to see an objective, to formalize it, to mobilize a group of people, and to get them to that objective. It's not the ability to push paper around, to sit at a desk and do that. Talk about leadership. It comes right back to pastoring. Pastor now is trying to lead the ship, but the pastor doesn't own the ship. Whose ship is it? It's God's ship. It's God's ship. Pastor is simply responsible to pilot it. Christ says to the pastor, "Here's the goal, here's the people. Now mobilize them and move them there." That's leadership. I have been trying to do this, encouraging some of our men. What I'm trying to do is I'm trying to pilot us into some in-home Bible studies where you would invite your neighbors, invite your friends, invite your coworkers. It's not to replace the church, but it takes us back to the book of Acts, where in every house they cease not to teach and preach Jesus. We've got to find a way in our lives on a regular basis, daily basis, to proclaim Jesus Christ. And we have gotten into the habit of coming to church Sunday morning, maybe Sunday night, and now we're doing our Wednesday nights online. And that's great that we meet, but not everybody does that. We need to become actively involved. Back to this leadership. In Revelation 18:17, go ahead and turn there with me. Revelation 18:17.
It says, "For in 1 hour so great riches has come to naught. And every shipmaster and all the company and ships and sailors and as many as trade by sea stood afar off." That describes the destruction of this Babylonian economic system in the tribulation as relative to people involved in the ship trade. The word shipmaster there is kubernetes, the same word. Very same word that translates governments in 1 Corinthians chapter 12 and verse 28. So the word can refer to someone who pilots a ship or someone that has responsibility for leadership. In Acts 27:11, you don't have to turn there, I'll read it. It says, "Nevertheless, the centurion believed the master and the owner of the ship more than those things which were spoken by Paul." The apostle was on his journey to Rome by ship, remember? And the ship encountered trouble from a storm. The word used there in Acts 27:11 for the pilot of the ship is the very same Greek word. Someone who charts the course and takes the people to the goal, a mobilizer, a mover of people. Just as an aside here, the word kubernetes is interesting because it's where we get the English word cybernetics. Cybernetics. Without getting in too much here because it'll hurt my head too. Cybernetics is a science that studies the brain relative to its governing the body. Okay, cybernetics. The brain says, hey, do this. Blink your eyes. Hey, turn to the left. Look over here. Take a step this way. Okay? It's piloting the body. So, there's also a distinction with wisdom. In the Greek translation of the Old Testament, okay, there's a Greek translation of the Old Testament, the Septuagint. There are four places where kubernetes is used. In these four places, we find that it's used in connection with wisdom. With wisdom. In Proverbs 12:5, it refers to wise counsel. So the comparison, there's an interesting comparison of the use of kubernetes in the Greek Old Testament, the translation. Ezekiel chapter 27 and verse 8 says this, "The inhabitants of Zidon and Avard were thy mariners, thy wise men, O Tyrus, that were in thee, were thy pilots." The word pilots is kubernetes. Kubernetes. So piloting the ship was connected with wisdom. Well, there's a contrast, as we have learned about wisdom. Wisdom is the ability to solve a problem by how? By making practical application of a principle to life. But there's a difference between someone who has wisdom in leadership and someone who has the gift of the word of wisdom. The word of wisdom is speaking out practical truths of the word of God. The wisdom in leadership is an enablement for someone to wisely approach and reach an objective. All right? One is exhibited speaking gift relative to claiming the word, while the other is more of a obscure directive by which some person reaches a goal. So we need to make that distinction so you don't think that just because someone is a leader that they have the word of wisdom. There are many people with wisdom in leadership but do not have the verbal ability of proclaiming that given by God to over a group of people. Some within the body of Christ have the ability of leadership. They know how to form objectives, directives to reach goal. They know how to mobilize people. Two words of defining the gift of leadership would be direction and decision making. Where am I going and how am I going to get there? That's what I'm trying to do. See, the church should be full of a lot of leaders. A lot of leaders. You should be leading somebody to a goal. What's the goal, you say? Well, my neighbor's lost. They need to get saved. That's a great goal. How are you going to get there? Maybe you organize a Bible study and say, hey,
We're going to have some coffee if you like that sort of thing, or tea if you like that sort of thing. Maybe some donuts. Who doesn't like donuts? Then we're going to sit down and we're going to just read God's word and just kind of have a nice time. Then maybe we're going to watch the game or something like that. Building a relationship. A true leader, like the true shipmaster in the storm, when the going gets rough, he hangs on. And guess what happens? Everybody reaches their destination. He has the ability to keep the ship on course during the storm. Some people, though, think that leadership is just right here. Just if you're up on the platform, you're the leader. Well, the Bible does talk that I'm an overseer, and they do that. But within the body, we have many leaders. First Timothy chapter 5, it talks about let the elders that rule well be counted worthy of double honor, especially they who labor in the word and doctrine. The fact that elders and pastors rule in the church assumes that God would give them the gift of leadership. Then, in fact, in Hebrews chapter 13 and verse 7, and verse 17, and verse 24 talks about those things. Let me read them. Verse 7, it says, remember them which have the rule over you, who have spoken unto you the word of God, whose faith follow, considering the end of their conversation. Obey them that have the rule over you, in verse 17, and submit yourselves, for they watch for your souls, as they that must give an account, that they might do it with joy and not with grief, for that is unprofitable for you. Sometimes people go, well, I don't like the direction you're going. Well, we can talk about those things, but remember that when we stand before God, I'm going to have to give an account for how I oversaw the people here and the needs. And verse 24 says, salute all them that have the rule over you, and all the saints, they of Italy, salute you. So the gift of leadership should be up here, but within the body there are many more leaders. Some churches just like to have one guy that rules and goes and says, this is what we do. When we have a situation, I like to talk to people. I like to talk to the men. What do you think? I remember when I took the pastorate here, a good pastor friend of mine said, now, you need a good yes man. And I said, I don't want yes men. I don't want somebody who's going to just say yes to everything I say. I want somebody that's going to say, hey, I put it out there, and you go, well, have you considered this? Well, no, I haven't. What are we doing? As a group of people, we're leading together. We're trying to come to the right direction so we can get to where we want to go. Remember in the book of Exodus, chapter 18, you had Moses there. And Moses would sit down, the Bible tells us, from morning to night, and the people would line up. Talk about getting in a line. They would line up. Be a long light, and they would bring their problems to him, and he'd say, this is what you need to do. This is what you need to do. This is what you need to do. And there was a fellow by the name of Jethro. You know who Jethro was? Jethro was his father-in-law. His father-in-law. And Jethro must have had the gift of leadership. And he stands back and he's watching this. You know, they said that there probably could have been as many as 2 million people that Moses was the leader of. Can you imagine? A pretty long line. I mean, I go over here to In-N-Out Burger, I get in a long line sometimes, okay? Praise the Lord, they're pretty good about getting you in and out of there, right? In and out. But as this is going on, Jethro's there and he's looking, he's watching this going on. He says, what are you doing? Well, he said, they come to me with their problems. He says, I know that. He said, but there are other people within this group of people that can do that. Why don't you put somebody that would work with this many people, and then somebody would be over this group of people, and they can come to them, and this over here. Now, if there's a real big problem, they can come back to you. They can come back to you. That's leadership. Romans chapter 12 gives us another aspect of this leadership. It says, he that ruleth with diligence, He that ruleth with diligence. The word diligent basically means speed or haste. The Strong's Concordance says this: with earnestness in accomplishing, promoting, or striving after anything. And haste and speed is secondary. Who's a good leader? I got to work on this one. Someone who recognizes a need and then acts on it. I appreciate Brother Dwayne. He comes to me and he goes, "Pastor, this needs to be fixed." I go, "Okay. How much money we got can we do it? Yeah, let's do that. Let's get that done. Fix the door back there. There's a lot of things being done as we get around here." Which reminds me, we got to get back on and finish the nursery. And then we got to get to work in that prophet's chamber as well. But someone who recognizes the needs and acts quickly. We should never let a problem go any longer than it already has. So we're going to get on those things. Now, some of the Corinthians had the gift of leadership, but they weren't using it. Why? Because it wasn't. Remember, we have to go back now to the early part of 1 Corinthians in the first several chapters going up to what, because once you get to verse 12 through 14, that's where Paul, and that's where we're at, is talking about the gifts. He's trying to get them straight about that. But he's talking about what they were doing. But they were busy doing things that were trying to use gifts that were like maybe the speaking in tongues and things like that, because that kind of brought it back to them. It was kind of showy. It's like, look at me. Look at what I'm doing. Aren't I a good Christian? Aren't I a good Christian? And they didn't have time to lead. You know, it's work to lead. And that's why we see in chapter 14 of 1 Corinthians, verse 33, it says, "For God is not the author of confusion, but of peace." And then in verse 33, and then verse 40, it says, "Let all things be done decently and in order." In other words, instead of everyone doing what is spectacular, showing how good I look, somebody organize. Get some objectives. Get some directives. That's what I'm looking for in the body here. Somebody that wants to lead. Come to me. Let's figure out how to make that work. This gift is a great need. The ability to see an objective, to mobilize a group of people and to reach out to that objective. The ability to get a burden and saying, "God, I want to be a witness and testimony. How can I do that?" When you're sitting there in your house, and I'm thinking, it's a great opportunity. You have the ability to invite folks into your home. You might have one show up, you might have 10 show up. And yes, it does kind of put you on the spot, because you got to live a certain way, because they need to see there's something different going on in your life. They recognize that you're like them, you have problems, and yet somehow it doesn't seem to consume you. You're able to get through that. So God has given leaders to his church. It's not an easy responsibility, because there are people who react negatively to what you do or what you say. And you know, folks, I don't mind at all someone critiquing. But a lot of times we just are good at criticizing without another way to do it. If you want to come up to me and say, "Pastor, I know that you're trying to accomplish this, but have you considered about going about it this way?" I might say, "You know what? That is a great idea. Let's do that. Let's do that." Remember, and keep this in mind, and I'll be done, that as you use your gift, and again, we may not be able to identify, I have the gift of, like that. But as you come in and God has painted you with his primary gifts in your life, and he's got that beautiful, unique color on you, and you use it within the body here, you always operate that gift in an atmosphere of love. This is something that really bothers me, when someone might get up and uses God's word, and they speak it in such a way that they seem angry at you. Oh my, but for the love of God, where would any of us be? How dare I try to use by the strength of my voice and display anger in an effort to manipulate you into doing something that God says, this is all you got to do, is just walk in my spirit. Walk in my spirit, and you'll have so many things straightened out in your life. The second serving gift is for next week. Every head bowed, every eye closed. Every head bowed and every eye closed. Thank you so much for being attentive and listening. I know it seems like we are really laboring on these gifts, but folks, I want you to at least have been told what they are and how we're to use them and why we're to use them. God wants us to be filled with His Spirit. This morning, you may have shown up here this morning and you say, I don't know what spirit you're talking about. Well, I'm simply saying this, that about 2,000 years ago, there was a baby born miraculously, and that baby's name was Jesus, and He lived a sinless life, and He did that so that He'd be the perfect sacrifice. By the way, the only sacrifice that could atone for all of mankind's sin and could pay the penalty of your sin. And He died on the cross, and He shed His blood simply that no person would have to die and spend eternity without Him. And by the way, that eternity would be in an everlasting lake of fire that was created for the devil and his angels. Maybe you've come here and you go, you know, I don't belong to a church. Perhaps God is speaking to your heart about joining yourself to this body. See, God fitly joins the body together. He's putting you somewhere. You should belong to a church somewhere. And have you joined yourself to this church? Perhaps you're here and you're just dealing with demons that are oppressing you. You are afflicted with some addiction. I would say this, folks, and I'm praying very earnestly about it, about doing studies on addictions. All of us have some sort of addictions. Whatever your need is this morning, I'm going to have a word of prayer. The altars will be open. There's not going to be any music, but I'll ask you to stand with heads bowed and eyes closed after I pray. And then if you have a need, come forward. Father, have your will and way in these lives today. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Stand with me, if you will. Heads bowed and eyes closed. The altar's open.